good to be back, and I was away for 2 weeks. That's why I couldn't preach last weekend. I was in Timor-Leste, got back only on Saturday night, so I couldn't preach that weekend. And then immediately on Monday, I went to Taiwan, and it was a very rushed meeting. We flew all the way there and put our things down and have dinner with certain people. The next day, we took a two-hour high-speed train ride to Kaohsiung, meet the people, and then by nighttime we took two hours back, and then the following morning we check out and go down to Taichung and meet people all the way through the night. And then the next day we have a meeting up to the last minute. We took a train to the airport to fly back, and on the way there one very well-known pastor said, "I got to meet you and talk to you." So we met in the restaurant in the airport before I take off. But it was a very fruitful thing. Thank you for praying for me, and things it's exciting to see what God is doing. We just want to ask the Lord to open our hearts so that His Spirit of truth will prevail in our midst, so that we will not just hear the reasoning of the mind, but we will experience the opening of our hearts. So ask the Lord to speak to us. Let's pray together. Father, we just ask that You will speak Your truth into our heart. I ask, O Lord, that the Spirit of truth will arise in our midst so that we would understand, not just with our mind, but in our heart, the reality of Your presence and of Your greatness in our lives. And Father, we want to apply the blood of Jesus that flows from His face that restores us into the dignity and the significance with which You have created us, so that we will not be robbed of that sense of destiny that we have in You, which is taken away from us as a result of the deception of this world and of the evil one. We ask that that deception will be pulled back, that blindness of our heart will be receded, so that this morning every person will hear Your truth. I pray for those who have never given their life to You. Lord, I ask that You will remove that blind spot, that obstacle that caused them to take that step of faith, and that this day will be the day of salvation. So humbly we ask that You would allow every word that's spoken here be the very words of God. We thank You, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. This message, in the third of a series of messages on developing a biblical worldview, is entitled The Deception of Darwinism. I want to open with the grand declaration of the Word of God. Genesis 1, 26 to 28. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So God created in His own image man. In the image of God He created him, male and female He created them. Then God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth, subdue it, have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on earth." The Bible tells us that you and I are the special creation of God. We are intelligently designed by the Maker of the universe. He has created us with a purpose to live and a destiny to fulfill as we pursue it. However, the devil, who was one of the most beautiful angels God has created, became envious of us. He sought to destroy us in order to undermine the authority and the image of God in us. He succeeded to tempt us to doubt the love of God and the purpose of God for us. And when man sinned, the holy God cannot allow sin in His presence, so He drove us out of His presence. However, He loved us so much that He came in the person of Jesus Christ to die for our sin, to break that rebellion and that faithlessness in our heart, so that we can have a way back to God and be restored to the original state of having a relationship with God in fulfilling His destiny for us. The Bible tells us that still now He is committed to prevent us from experiencing that relationship with God. And His primary tool is the tool of deception, because the Bible says the devil is a liar from the beginning. And so he works in the minds of the whole world. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4, the Bible tells us that Satan, who is a god of this world, has blinded the minds of those who don't believe. They are unable to see the glorious light of the good news. They don't understand the message about the glory of Christ, who is the exact likeness of God. But even for us believers who have given our life to Jesus Christ, while the devil tried to block it out from people so that they would not even come close to accept Christ, but for us who have a moment of revelation and come and give our life to Christ, God tells us that the devil still wants to rob us of the fullness of experiencing His goodness by deceiving our minds. And so the Apostle Paul in Colossians chapter 2, verse 8 warns us. He said, "Don't let anyone capture you." He's talking to Christian now. Christian can be under captivity to capture you with empty philosophies and high-sounding nonsense. High-sounding nonsense that come from human thinking and from the spiritual power of this world rather than from Christ. I want to show you that Darwinism is high-sounding nonsense. I make no bones about it. And by the end of this message, you will understand why. One of such great deception comes from a man by the name of Charles Darwin. He postulated the theory of evolution. We cannot help but to surface him and expose this deception because this theory of his is a primary and supposedly scientific theory that is used to persuade people that there is no God. That's why we cannot avoid but to point it up and call this into account. In recent years, there's a new movement called New Atheism that promotes a belief that God is but a delusion. One of his chief promoters who wrote this book entitled The God Delusion, he is Richard Dawkins. And I want you to hear about this new atheism that permeates almost every university in the world, including us, that basically uses the evolution theory to destroy the idea that there is a God. Listen to him.
When we go into a garden and we see how beautiful it is, and we see coloured flowers, and we see the butterflies and the bees, of course, it's natural to think there must be a gardener. Any fool is likely to think there must be a gardener. The huge achievement of Darwin was to show that that didn't have to be true. Of course, it's difficult. Of course, it had to wait until the mid-19th century before anybody thought of it. It seems so obvious that if you've got a garden, there must be a gardener who created it and all that goes with that. What Darwin did was to show the staggeringly counterintuitive fact that this not only can be explained by an undirected process, it's not chance, by the way, entirely wrong to say it's chance. It's not chance. Natural selection is the very opposite of chance, and that's the essence of it. That was what Darwin discovered. He showed not only a garden, but everything in the living world, and in principle, not just on this earth, but on any other planet, wherever you see the organized complexity that we understand, that we call life, that it has an explanation which can derive it from simple beginnings by comprehensible, rational means. That is possibly the greatest achievement that any human mind has ever accomplished. Not only did he show that it could be done, I believe that we can argue that that the alternative is so unparsimonious and so counter to the laws of common sense that, reluctant as we might be, because it might be unpleasant for us to admit it, although we can't disprove that there's a God, it is very, very unlikely indeed.
Heard how convincing this is? He says, guys, you look at a garden and it's beautiful. You've got to believe that there's a gardener. It's natural. That is our intuition. But what Darwin came up with is an explanation that does not require God as an explanation, and therefore, counterintuitive as it may be, he has shown us that God is unlikely. Even if We find it difficult to accept. Can you see how it is? The whole new atheism is built on the theory of evolution. That's why we got to survey it and we got to decimate it. In fact, I want to say to you that Richard Dawkins go on to say, it is absolutely safe to say, if you meet someone who claims not to believe in evolution, that person is ignorant, stupid, or insane, or wicked. And I'd rather not consider that. Sir Julian Huxley, a eugenicist, advocate of natural selection theory, said, Darwin's theory is no longer a theory, but a fact. Darwinism has come of age, so to speak. We are no longer having to bother about establishing the fact of evolution. It is established as fact. It's no longer a theory. We don't even care about having to prove it because it is done. Carl Sagan, the man that I showed you on a video the last time I preached to you, an astronomer, cosmologist, made this statement. He said, evolution is a fact amply demonstrated by fossil record and by contemporary molecular biology. Natural selection is a successful theory devised to explain the fact of illusion. Not illusion. Evolution, which is close to it. There's a Freudian flip there, right there. Really? Evolution is a fact amply demonstrated by fossil record and by molecular biology? I challenge this assertion this morning. I want to challenge its truthfulness and submit to you that Darwinism is a deception. In fact, I want to show you that the fossil record and the molecular biology show the exact opposite. It shows that there is intelligent design. Now, before I proceed, I want to make something clear what I want to talk about this morning. Darwinism is not just about some process of evolutionary changes in which within a species, organism begins to adapt to the environment. It may be possible. I'm not arguing whether there's ever some kind of evolutionary process that might begin within some species. I'm not discussing that. I can accept even that possibility. I'm not advocating that because that's not the contention of what I want to say. What I am saying is that I am addressing this as the crux of Darwinism is not just about having some evolutionary process, but that theory of evolution states that everything comes from one source, one simple cell. Because if evolution is just about some evolutionary process, then evolutionaries don't have to be an atheist. They don't have to be. They can say God actually used this process. But that's not Darwinism in its basic understanding. What we must understand is that Darwinism, as we know it today, believes that all of life comes from non-life. Just like you say, the whole garden is planted by this process. And the process of evolution is a process where simple natural matter, given enough time, will organize itself and become extremely complex and into life itself. It was in 1859, in a country estate 30 miles south of London, in the city of Down, where it became the ground zero for scientific revolution. Here in the solitude of his study, Charles Darwin completed his landmark book entitled On the Origin of Species. You can see a picture of that book there. In it, Darwin attempts to explain how every organism that ever lived originated from one common ancestor as a result of natural selection acting on random variation. The process of evolution was discussed throughout. What Darwin did was to advance the hypothesis that everything has an original ancestry, and a thousand or million generations from now, your great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandchildren will be of a different species no longer human. Common descent and natural selection became the twin pillar of modern biology. Let me describe that process in short of what he's saying. Somehow millions of years ago, this lifeless material of element, gases, other substance gave rise to the first cell. And then over millions of years, this one cell began to mutate, make changes to survive the environment. And they make only small changes in its structure and nature one at a time. Changes don't work that don't work will be discarded because they don't survive, they die off. Changes that work will be retained. For example, you have suddenly someone grow with one leg. It doesn't work. After a generation, it dies. Then someone grow with six legs and they trip each other and they fall to pieces and it dies. And after a while, you either have two legs or four legs and something that will survive. Something that's stable will survive and the rest will be discarded. And this process is called natural selection. It presumes that there is no need of any design or designer, but nature itself making these changes. In other words, it is totally undirected. I want you to understand that this is Darwinism at its core, and this is what we got to reject and attack as a lie. And they say they took billions of years because these changes are very, very slow. And given the billion and billions of years, the first cell became more and more complex, and every organism was formed, and after millions of changes, some adapt to the sea, some adapt to the land, some even adapt to the sky. And now we have our birds, our fish, our animals, including man today. But every species on land, in water, and in air comes from this first cell. Darwin calls it the tree of life. Take a look at this diagram. This is what we come up with. He's saying they all started from the same root. It all came from one thing, one cell, some elements, and it started. And when it started, it makes small changes, adapt to the whole environment because it has life. And then after a while, it makes changes, and then different species are formed. And finally, we have right on top where we see the animal kingdom and all the living creatures as we see today. This diagram shows that all living creatures or organisms come from one source. Please understand that. What Dawkins, which is what I show him, Richard Dawkins, is saying that this is as good as fact. That's what they say. The scientists say, this is fact, proven. Done, QED. And counterintuitive as we may feel, although some of us feel something is wrong and there must be a God, I tell you, he says, subdue that, because we must come to the conclusion that there is no God. And this is the deception, I believe, is from the pit of hell. As I prepare this, I can tell you that I was more sympathetic with this scientist who was trying to find answer. I came to the conclusion that they are deliberate liars. And the Chinese phrase that comes to me is, yao yan huo zhong. Evil thoughts that permeate and pollute the whole society. And I'm going to put forth scientific reasoning that dispel this myth, and that there is an existence of God. We must bring to light this untruth. And in order to do that, I want to show you two major reasons why this is not true. The first reason has to do with fossil evidence. The second major reason has to do with biological or molecular biology. And in both of this track, it shows not only does it not support Darwinism, it actually points to intelligent design. So let's go one at a time. Now, it sounds a bit, you know, some of you say, why so atas? Why can't Pastor Khong just talk about Jesus loves me, this I know? Well, I spent a lot of time talking about that, but because you now must put on your thinking cap, because all you do is, Jesus loved me, this I know, and then you walk out and put on a thinking cap that is filled with deception. After a while, you have doubt about God, and Jesus loved me, this I know, become just a subjective feeling. It's nothing but spiritual existentialism. So I want you to put on your thinking cap and know that science points to intelligent design. So the first track, the first line of argument against this deception is the inadequacy of fossil evidence. And I want to put a positive statement here. As we see the inadequacy of fossil evidence, in fact, the fossil evidence shows that we are fearfully made. Like the psalmist says, I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. So let's go down this whole idea of fossil evidence. Let me explain. Some of you don't know what fossils are. Now, for this to study what is past, we don't need archaeologists. Archaeologists are studying bones of human beings, little pottery, because that is very early in history. But when you go to millions and millions of years, you don't have these things anymore. What happened is all the organism or life form has been fossilized. Fossilized means they become rocks. They become just like rock. Therefore, the people who study it are not archaeologists, but geologists, people who study the formation of rock and the intricacy of rock. And they discover fossils of these prehistoric organisms. And so I want to go down this. There is so much lack of evidence that it is incredible that anyone who say that Darwinism is fact is lying to us and lying to themselves. I want to establish that today. And along this line, there are two things that stand out. First is the stark absence of transitional life form or organism. Second is the overwhelming abundance of highly complex organism. Are you with me? This is the first track. Let's talk about fossil. And as we look at this fossil, there are two things that really work against Darwinism. One is the complete absence of intermediary life form. And secondly, every fossil we have exhibits highly complex life organism. So let's talk about the stark absence of transitional organism. In 1831, the renowned geologist Adam Sedgwick began to excavate what is known today as the Cambrian rock strata in northern Wales. It's one of the lowest strata, one of the oldest level of earth that we can find. The Cambrian rock strata is recognized as one of the oldest level of rock structure when they find fossils of prehistoric organisms. And they're all over the world, and they're all similar. Wherever you go in the world, you look at this layer, you find the same thing. It is found in Canada, in Wales, and the latest is in China, Chengjiang in Yunnan. As near as only in the 1960s and 1970s, they discovered it. And they're all exactly the same, all right? But when this first was discovered by geologist Adam, he was assisted by one of the newly graduate of Cambridge University by the name of Charles Darwin. And when they discovered that, it became a mystery that Charles Darwin pondered into his old age and passed on into the future generation this mystery that is known in the scientific world as the Cambrian explosion. Now, let me explain to you why such discovery and why they call it a mystery and the Cambrian explosion. This is when they look at this level, they discover that this was when animals first colonized the whole earth. There was a veritable explosion of life. It's an explosion in that there was enormous diversification. Right before this strata, that's just below it, there's no fossil at all. Got it? You take it, lower than that, older than that, nothing, zero, zilk. You hit this, bang! All the animals are there. All the animals form are there. In great diversity, and it doesn't matter which part of the world you go to, as you dig, you find this sudden explosion of animals. These geologists were excited. They were filling barrels and barrels with lots of different types of organisms. These were organisms with nervous system, with compound eyes, that can move very quickly. It took the world by storm. In spite of that, that they found this, where all the animals, zoom, appears. Now, these are not animals as we know it today, like dog or cat, but they are the prehistoric form of animal. Later, I'll talk about how complex they are. But anything underneath that, zilk, zero. In spite of that, 30 years later, Charles Darwin still wrote his book on the origin of species. And then when he wrote that book, he admitted that this Cambrian discovery is a major problem to his theory. And this is what he wrote. Charles Darwin said, "If my theory were true, it is indisputable that before the lowest Cambrian stratum was deposited, long period elapsed, and during these periods of time, the world swarmed with living creatures. To the question why we do not find rich fossiliferous deposit belonging to these assumed earlier periods prior to Cambrian, I can give no satisfactory answer." Remember, the man who wrote this said, "I look at this," and this happened 30 years ago. He said that, "I look at this, in fact, below this, there should be lots of other fossils, and why it suddenly appear, I have no satisfactory answer." Because he admitted this posed as a problem until his die. Why? For two reasons. First, if the process of natural selection is slow and slight process over millions of years, then one would expect him, as Darwin himself admit, that there will be many intermediary fossils. Listen to what he said. "The number of intermediate varieties which have formerly existed on Earth must be truly enormous. Why then is not every geological formation and every stratum full of such intermediate links? Geology assuredly does not reveal any such finely graded organic chain. And this perhaps is the most obvious and the gravest objection which can be argued against my theory." Got it? Got it? You hear it from the man himself, the man who wrote this that took the world by storm. And today the new atheists say that because of his brilliant genius, we don't need God. This man said, "I look at the geological record and I say, how come there is not the intermediary fossil that formed this stable organism? There should be lots of it." You know, because the changes are to be very slow. You know what I mean? You develop a six finger, a seven finger, and after a while, those with six finger and seven finger, you know, get in the way and they just die off. And for every stable change, there got to be millions of try before you even hit it. He said, we should expect this, and the fact is we don't find it. This is a serious challenge to my theory. Dr. David Berlinsky, educator, author, critique of the evolution theory, senior fellow at Discovery Institute Center for Science and Culture. He published a book called The Devil's Delusion, Atheism and Its Scientific Pretensions. He wrote that. He said the question has to be raised and should be raised whenever an evolutionary sequence is mentioned. What exactly are the predicted properties we expect to find as one passes from a land-dwelling creature to a sea-dwelling creature? Specifically, how many changes are required to bring a land-dwelling creature to a sea-dwelling creature? Curiously enough, this is not a question which evolutionary biologists ask a whole lot. A rough estimation is about 50,000 morphological changes for a land-going creature to become a sea-dwelling creature. That means for one to move from the land to the sea or the sea to the land, you must have 50,000 actual changes. For every one of the 50,000, there got to be millions of try before one change becomes stabilized. You understand? This is incredible. Once we introduce a quantitative qualification, then a lot of complication is brought into the picture. If the Darwinian incremental changes have to be small, where are the 49,000 changes? These are arbitrary changes. Creatures must have these changes to survive in the ocean. Any attempt to put a quantitative requirement should put a profound sense of complexity. These changes are so much greater in any of the transitional record. What is the explanation for this? And I'm not even talking about birds that can fly. Human being discovered that the mechanism for an animal that can run, and once you take off, some of us are pilots here or aeronautical engineers, the minute you take off the land, a whole different set of mechanism kicks in, completely different. How does this happen? Nobody can answer. If there are those transition forms, where are they? Now, please understand that Dr. David Belinsky is not a believer. He is an educated philosopher. He's a senior fellow of this, you know, Discovery Institute Center for Science. He's a critic of the theory of evolution. But Belinsky refused to theorize about the origins of life and describe himself as a secular Jew. He's not even an Orthodox Jew. A secular Jew is one who don't really believe in Judaism or maybe in this whole idea of God. Dr. Belinsky went on to say, please understand that I don't have the answer. He said, at least I'm honest. But neither do the other guys. In my opinion, they refuse to recognize the legitimacy of this question. If there are so many changes are required, why are they not shown in the fossil record? Understand? Boom! Suddenly, all the forms are there. No intermediary fossil. No evidence of what Darwin considered as gradual change to make it into a stable organism. None. Let me take you even one step deeper. And the next argument is even stronger. Not only are there no intermediary fossil, the fossil that we discover all over the world, there is an overwhelming abundance of highly complex organisms. The Cambrian discovery is also called the Cambrian explosion because suddenly everything appeared. Not only that, scientists have studied these fossils for close to 200 years now. And they found more and more of this fully formed organism. They discovered that they are highly complex. They have nervous system, as I said, mentioned earlier. They have compound eyes, mechanism that allow them to move very fast. In other words, they are very high level on the Darwinian tree of life. In fact, scientists recognize that these forms are called what you call phylum. Now, don't worry about big words, but you know, phylum. What are phylum? Plural is phyla. Phylum are the basic types of animal or living organism. They are fully developed body plan or blueprint. In other words, when they found it on the Cambrian, there are all these basic phylum that are the basic blueprint or body plan of all the animals we have today. Since then, there are no changes. There are no crossing of this phylum. There's no one that can evolve into another phylum. Everything as we know it today belongs to one of this phylum type. Darwinism of evolution will expect a bottom-up structure. From one cell, become highly, you know, organized, and slowly they split up into different phylums. We would discover that. But we find that this was a top-down thing. And the first time we found the fossil, bang, all this original body plans, blueprints, are there from the beginning. And everything we see today is but a development of this basic new, basic body type. No new phylum has been discovered. Based on the body plan of the animal, we divide animal into major groups. They are the vertebrates, like us, the backbone, strong inside, and soft on the outside. They are the arthropods, which are the hard skeleton on the outside and soft body on the inside. These are the insects or the crab. There's the echinoderms, which are the sea urchins and the starfish. And starfish are different from jellyfish and different from worms. They're all different phylum, different from crabs and lobster. But each group has its unique feature to make them very different from the next group. The stability of these forms in the animal that exemplify the distinct phyla contradicts Darwinian vision of interconnected tree of life. The phyla don't blend imperceptibly one into another. Anthropoids, for example, didn't evolve from chordates or mollusks under the offspring of sponges. Instead, a phylum is in fact as different as it can be from another phylum. So how did these differences arise? Look at the tree of life again. What they're saying is, from this different phylum, what we discover is none of this below, and bang! The first time we hit the fossil, that's all. And you go anything deeper, you can't find anything that even resembles this intermediary changes. Let me show you a video on this.
This top-down pattern of biological development can be compared to the development of human technology.
If you look at any major invention, like the automobile, for example, the basic body design is set in place from the very beginning. You've got four wheels, a chassis, a drive shaft, two axles. There are certain basic features of all automobiles that have persisted since Ford and Benz got the whole thing going over a century ago.
In the decades that followed the introduction of the automobile's basic framework, designers and engineers have created thousands of variations on the original theme. But regardless of differences in size, color, and chassis design, the foundational body plan remains consistent to its original form.
And an interesting thing about the fossil record is that there's a similar top-down pattern evident in the history of life. The basic body plan of the arthropod phylum has a segmented torso, jointed legs, and an exoskeleton, all of which arose suddenly at the beginning of the Cambrian explosion. And today we still see the continuity of this original plan, this foundational idea, in over a million species of animals.
This top-down pattern looks nothing like the predictions of Darwin's theory.
Darwin's theory is that there's a tree of life where you have one organism diverging into many other organisms and big differences appearing at the top. What we really see is from here up. This does not exist in the fossil record.
You got it? It's as clear as day. There's no evidence. Now, the best that Darwin and other scientists that subscribe to this evolutionary theory can come up with is that all the transitional life form has been lost. Now, that's pretty convenient. And Charles Darwin knows that this is a major problem. So how did he get around it? This is what he said. He said that geological record is extremely imperfect. And this fact will, to a large extent, explain why we do not find intermediate varieties, connecting together all the extinct and existing form of life by the finest graduated steps. He who reject this view on the nature of the geological record will rightly reject my whole theory. He says that they were all just lost. That's very convenient, okay? So we don't find this. And people who can't accept this explanation will reject my theory. At least he's honest. Then he said further, I look at the geological record as a history of the world imperfectly kept and written in a changing dialect. Of this history, we possess the last volume alone, relating only to the two or three countries. Of this volume, only here and there a short chapter has been preserved, and of each page, only here and there a few lines. Basically, he's saying this. Perhaps the paleontological discovery, digging through the rock, needed more time. That the transition forms are out there, but they are not discovered yet. And enough time that is given collecting this data, these forms will show up, and it will be there. Got it? It will be there. But so far, it's not there. They have to admit it. Now, more than 100 years have passed. Are these things getting better? The fact is that the things have not changed much. In fact, when oil companies begin to drill for oil in the oceans, more samples were obtained even from the depth of the ocean floor, and they discovered that the soil in the ocean floor is even younger than the Cambrian layer, and there is nothing there. It was David Robb, who himself is an evolutionary, who tried to defend it, but he has to admit, he said, we are now about 120 years after Darwin, and the knowledge of the fossil record has been greatly expanded. We now have a quarter of a million fossil species, but the situation hasn't changed much. The record of evolution is still surprisingly jerky, and ironically, we have even fewer examples of evolutionary transition than we had in Darwin's time. Listen, he said that we have spent 100 over years finding we have not found anything new. Can you just watch this video?
During the past 150 years, fossil hunters have searched the Earth for the many transitional links Darwin's theory requires.
If I sent you on a treasure hunt and said, what I really want is this, you're going to go out and look for this, whatever it happens to be. Well, if you come at the fossil record with a Darwinian expectation of an abundance of transitionals, that's what's going to get you a professorship. You find those transitional forms. So all over the world, in countless outcrops, people have been looking for those forms that would capture the major transitions in the history of life.
This search has extended from the walls of the Grand Canyon to the shores of the Irish Sea. And as countless specimens have been excavated, one question endures. How complete is the Cambrian fossil record?
I think the Cambrian fossil record is surprisingly complete. I think it may be more complete than we realise. The reason for that is, for instance, if you look at the stratigraphy of the world, if I go and collect Cambrian rocks in Wales and find Turton fossils, if I then go to China, I don't find the same species, but I find the same sorts of fossils. If I go into Carboniferous rocks, I go to Canada, they're the same as what I find in this country. So there is a clear set of faunas and floras which take us through geological time. The overall framework is falling into position.
There's no question that if you dig and sample more, you're going to find new kinds of fossils. But generally speaking, the fossils that we find fall into groups that we already knew about. When you see that, what I think nature is telling you is you've got a pretty good sample of the history of life on Earth. The groups that you already had established are the ones that capture the new fossils.
To the paleontologists, the lack of intermediate fossils is well known. Some people still think that if you look long and hard enough, you will eventually find them. But I think most of the paleontologists that I have been in contact would not have that hope very high. They simply feel that we have looked long and hard enough, and that they are not there. They are not there.
The difficulty of assigning any good reason for the absence of vast piles of strata, rich in fossils, beneath the Cambrian system is very great. The case at present must remain inexplicable and may be truly urged as a valid argument against the views here entertained.
You look at a Chinese man talking. He is an American-born Chinese, Dr. Paul Chen. He actually went to Chenjiang Yunnan, and he was digging, and this is what he said. He said he actually dug below the Cambrian fossil, and you know what he found? He found microscopic embryos. He could take it back to his laboratory, even isolate them, look inside, and see what it is. And his argument is this: if beneath this layer, even simple things like embryo can be preserved, if there were intermediary fossil, they certainly will be there. Now, let me summarize this. How insidious and how unprofessional and how lack of integrity it is where the scientific world make those statements. Darwin postulated that all of life begin from one source, and there are hundreds of millions of years, and all these organisms, bird, fish, animal, shellfish, all came from there. The problem is that the fossil record we have show that there are no transitional organism form found, and given the fact that one species to evolve into another, there will be millions of them, and after almost 150 years, we couldn't find any more fossils that shows the existence of transitional life form, and most importantly, all these fossils that we discover are highly complex and contain all the body plans of all creatures we have today, and there is no crossing over. Now, if I am the judge in a court case and this case is brought to me, I'll throw out the case and say, I wouldn't even consider that. Imagine you say, I'm sure you murdered your friend, all right? And you bring the case up. I say, are there any evidence? No, we're still looking. You know what I'll say? Keep looking until you find it before you bring it to me. Don't waste my time. Now I'm asking you, the scientist knows that. But a man like Carl Sagan, Huxley, Richard Dawkins will say that evolution is not a theory, it is a fact. It's not even worthy of being a theory right now. Theory must have some evidence to support it. It can only be a hypothesis that is yet to be secure. It's a nice picture you can draw on a book, but it doesn't show up in any evidence, and the evidence points against it. And even the founder himself recognized that is a major problem. You see, creation is God's idea. The Bible says in Genesis chapter 1, verse 20 to 25, then God said, let the waters abound with an abundance of living creature. Let the birds fly above the earth across the face of the firmament of the heaven. So God created great sea creatures and every living thing that moves, with which waters abounded according to their kind, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And it was evening and morning, the fifth day. Then God said, let the earth bring forth the living creature according to its kind, cattle, creeping things, and beasts of the earth, each according to his kind. And it was so. And God made the beasts of the earth according to his kind, cattle according to his kind, and everything that creeps on earth according to his kind. And then God said, I have another idea. Let us make man in our own image, according not just to his kind, but to our image. And let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, over the cattle, over the whole earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. And God blessed them and said, I give you a destiny. Be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth. Subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, over every living thing that moves on earth. We are made by an awesome God. That's why when the psalmist say, I am fearfully made, what does it mean? It means it strikes a sense of fear, a good sense of fear and awe within me to think that Almighty God spoke me into being, created me according to his image. He spoke life into me. He releases his power through his word, and I and you came into being. My creation is not random. It is intentional when God said, I will make man in God's image, and you are awesomely made. That's what the psalmist is saying. I'm fearfully made means it is awesome. My God, my creator is awesome, and I am awesome. Will you turn to the guy next to you and say, you are awesome. You are not the result of an accident. You are awesome. There are more fossil records that point to that direction than to the direction that you will evolve from just simple cells. I'm only halfway done, guys. If you think that this is strong against the deception of Darwinism, my next line of approach is even stronger. First, I'm talking about a fossil record. It doesn't show evolution. In fact, it points against it. There is no intermediary life form. And the forms that we have all around the world are of highly complex structure. Now, let's go on the track of molecular biology. Let me go on this. And on molecular biology, The argument against evolution is simply this. It's the complexity of that single cell. And when you examine a simple cell, you will come to the conclusion that you are not only fearfully or awesomely made, but you are wonderfully made. You are wonderfully made. You see, in the first reason, when I deal with fossil, we're dealing with biological evolution. So we study the fossil. It doesn't measure up to what has been claimed. Now, in this second reason, we now need to deal with not just biological evolution, but chemical evolution. Chemical evolution has to do with how do these lifeless substance, this chemical, this gas, this element come together and arrive at the first cell. Isn't that a problem? Those three has been demolished. I mean, at least you don't see this in any evidence. But now we ask, because Darwinism is not just about this process, it's about we all originated from the same ancestry, which the scientists say is non-life. The question is, how did the first cell occur? The idea of how we get a first cell turned out to be a very important question and a problem. How do we get from all this simple non-living chemical that first living cell organism? The question we need to explore is there any appearance of design in this first cell? Or can this first cell be explained away by some undirected mechanism? Or it is better to explain it by actual intelligent design? So let's talk about the simple cell. As far back as the 19th century, which is 1860s and 70s, and the immediate decades after the publication of this book, Origin of Species, scientists extended Darwin's thinking back further in time. Darwin never tried to explain how you get the first life, although he postulated this. They did not think it was a problem or a hard thing to do because they thought that a simple cell was really simple. It's kind of a simple blob of plasm. They call it protoplasm. It's kind of like jelly, all right? Very simple, just one piece of jelly, you know, but has organism inside, has life. That's the idea of what the cell is. The cell to them is just something simple, gooey, and if that's the concept of a cell, maybe by just some two or three simple a step or some, you know, and there's a scientist even show that you put lightning and thunder in it, vroom, something live comes out, okay? And they're trying to find this first cell. Well, in the last 50 years, the knowledge of the cell has just exploded. Scientists discovered that a single cell is extremely complex. There are two problems in forming these complex cells. Again, hang in there with me. Big words, but simple ideas. I will explain that to you. When you look at a simple cell, you find that it's very complex. There are two problems. The first problem is a problem of irreducible complexity. Irreducible complexity. You see, remember the last sermon, I talked about cosmology, and since the invention of this huge telescope, we look at the universe, we know the universe has a beginning. But in the last 50 years, we have discovered and invented not just huge telescope, we have invented amazing microscope. And we can even look into the cell. And you know what they discover? They discover that within a cell, it's just a cell, I'm not talking about inside a cell. You know how big is a cell? You take a timber full of cultured cell, there are billions of cells inside there. All right, now you go into one of those billions of cells and you look inside, and in every cell, they discovered there are molecular machines that do a lot of work. I want to know, you know, really how small it is, huh? They are little trucks that carry supplies to one end of the cell to another. Some of these machines are dedicated to capture energy of the sunlight and turn it into usable energy. Machines that facilitate blood clotting, helps breathing. There be one cell only, huh? I'm talking one cell. You know how big is a cell?
very small, huh? And then inside the cell, there are lots of molecular machines. They go, wow, work very hard, no? Supply energy, la, change this, la, and help the cell to grow, okay? And they discovered, for example, scientists have studied a lot on this particular machine called the bacteria flagellum. The bacteria flagellum, let's put a picture on it. Okay, now all these are within a cell. It has a tail that rotates at 100,000 revolutions per second. And it stops at half a turn and turns the other direction back at 100,000 rep per second. Let's take a look at this one of these things. It is like an outboard motor. And many of the scientists have studied, there's one scientist studied for more than 10 years. They zoom in and look at how this machine works. Show the next picture. This is how it works. It is an outboard motor. And to form this, by natural selection, is impossible. You know, natural selection say you must be slowly, one part form another. You cannot. Either you have the whole thing or you don't have it. Let me explain to you. I finally asked my guys to find myself a mouse trap. This kind of mouse trap is very hard to find. Maybe it's not very effective. You know? Have you ever tried to use this and the mouse will jump around? But anyway, this mouse trap consists of three parts. Very simple, all right? The first is this clam that delivers the fatal blow to the mouse, okay, and sometimes not so fatal, all right? There's this where you put the little bait there, and this is hooked onto this. I'm not going to set it up. I don't want to kill myself, okay? I'm not a mouse. I'm a human, okay? And so forth. Now, to form this simple mechanism, it cannot be at a little change at a time because you have these three parts. This part cannot form by itself because by definition, if it's useless, it will die off. Understand? It can only become stable if this is also together, and if this is also together, they must form at the same time. Otherwise, each part will die. Got me? Got it? This is called irreducible complexity. Either if this one evolved without this one will die. This one evolved without this one will die. It cannot happen. It can only happen when, boom, they all come together. And this is called irreducible complexity. And Darwin's theory basically say that if you can prove that anything must suddenly jump a big jump, my whole theory comes apart. It doesn't work. You understand? It's not possible. Now, Charles Darwin himself said this. He said, natural selection acts only by taking advantage of slight successive variation. You can never take a great sudden leap, but must advance by short and sure, though slow step. Charles Darwin go on to say, if it could be demonstrated that any complex organ existed which could not possibly be formed by numerous successive slight modification, my theory would absolutely break down. So watch this video.
Studies of the bacterial motor have indeed revealed an even deeper level of complexity. For its construction, not only requires specific parts, but also a precise sequence of assembly.
You've got to make things at the right time. You've got to make the right number of components. You've got to assemble them in a sequential manner. You've got to be able to tell if you've assembled it properly so that you don't waste energy building a structure that's not going to be functional.
Building a molecular machine has been compared to the construction of a house, where workers follow a detailed blueprint and plan for assembly. The foundation of a house is poured before the walls are erected. Plumbing and electrical fixtures are installed prior to enclosing the walls of the structure. Windows must be hung before siding is applied, and shingles are attached only after plywood sheets are nailed to the rafters. So it is with the construction of a flagellar motor.
You build this structure from the inside out. You are counting the number of components in a ring structure or the stator. And once that's assembled, there's feedback that says, okay, no more of that component. Now a rod is added, a ring is added, another rod is added, U-joints added. Once U-joints at a certain size and a certain degree of bend, about a quarter turn, that's shut off, and then you start adding components for the propeller. These are all made in a precise sequence, just like you would build a building.
To build a motor correctly requires a complex system of machines that coordinate the timing of the assembly instructions. But how could natural selection construct such a system?
The co-option argument doesn't explain this. You see, in order to construct that flagellar mechanism, or tens of thousands of other such mechanisms in the cell, you require other machines to regulate the assembly of these structures. And those machines themselves require machines for their assembly.
If even one of these pieces is missing or put in the wrong place, your motor isn't going to work. So this apparatus to assemble the flagellar motor is itself irreducibly complex. In fact, what we have here is irreducible complexity all the way down.
We know a lot about the bacterial flagellum. We still have a lot to learn, but we know a lot about it. And there's no explanation for how this complex molecular machine was ever produced by a Darwinian mechanism.
You got it? This is even worse than the fossil record. You have no evidence. But in this, how do you explain the formation of a cell? And we thought it was simple, but it's extremely complex. So the first problem is this problem of irreducible complexity that natural selection cannot ever develop. But there's even a more serious problem. You see, I'm going from the weak argument to the stronger argument. And the last part that has to do with molecular biology is the problem of not just irreducible complexity, but of informational complexity. That they discover in the cell, there are stored information. You see, natural selection cannot work. It can only work when there is life. You understand? You know what is natural selection? There's life, then there's natural selection. What do you mean by that? Because there's life, and then you find that you got one leg, you cannot move, okay? And you discover, oh, what a downer. And after a while, you die off, and people with one leg just die off, okay? And then those with six legs, they trip each other. And then, because there's life, life needs to survive. It's the survival of the fittest. And so life itself just finds its own thing. But where there is no life, there is no natural selection. It's correct. When Richard Dawkins say that natural selection is not just chance, it's correct, because there's life, it selects by itself. But there is no fossil evidence. But now when it comes to the cellular level, it is chance alone, because there is no life. You're saying at which point life begins to take place. So it's by pure chance. Sir Fred Hoyle, which I mentioned the last time I talked about cosmology, he's a cosmologist. He's not a biblical creationist, not even a Christian, but he eventually recognized the impossibility of Darwinian evolution. And this is what he wrote. The notion that not only the biopolymer, but the operating program of a living cell could be derived by chance in a prime ordeal organic soup here on Earth is evidently nonsense. Nonsense of a high order. Hoyle originated that famous illustration comparing the random emergence of even a simple cell to the likelihood of a tornado sweeping through a junkyard might assemble a Boeing 747 from the materials therein. Imagine a junkyard and a tornado hit it and everything fly out. When it came out, boom, 747. It will put Boeing out of business. That's the chance. Or the chance of even a single functioning protein being built from amino acid. Let me explain to you. The basic life substance is protein, all right? Now, let me explain to you. And how are protein formed? Protein are formed by joining amino acid. There's no life, all right? They're joined like that. But they must be joined at a specific sequence. If you change this to this, or you change this to this, or you're connected, it doesn't work, all right? Now, how many these are amino acids. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. For it to be in the exact sequence, the chances are very low.
Most proteins are at least 150 amino acids. Some go up as high as 400 to 500. They must be joined at a particular sequence so that they can kind of, by because it's helix form. Is it here? It's not very stable, is that telling you? Okay. And I'm telling you that these are just 2 points, but in a real amino acid, it is a helix. There are many, many points. All right? They must be joined at the right point so that when they twist together, now this is impossible, okay? But when they twist together, okay? You see, if they're not joined correctly, they fall apart. All right? Now that's what happened. He says that the chance of one protein arising from just a chance random guy, and there's no natural selection there because none of them have life. They just happen to like chance. Just try. They can try the same thing again and again also, all right? And they can do it. The chance of it succeeding is equivalent to a solar system full of blind men. You get it, the whole solar system, Jupiter, Mars, Pluto, Earth, everywhere, fill up every of this planet completely with blind people, give everyone a Rubik's Cube to solve, and the chance of it, all of them solve it at the same time. That's the chance of one protein evolving out of the amino acid. All right? Hoy eventually came to believe that the fine-tuning of the universe as a whole was further evidence of a designer. This is what he said. He said, a common sense interpretation of the facts suggests that a super intellect has monkeyed with physics. The numbers one calculates from the facts seems to me so overwhelming as to put this conclusion almost beyond question. My atheism was greatly shaken by this development. He never became a Christian from what we know, but he said, my atheistic view has been challenged. Edwin Conklin, okay, a biologist, put it this way. He says the probability of life originating from accident is comparable to the probability of an unabridged dictionary result from an explosion in a printing shop. Wilder Smith, the British organic chemist, said one might just as well maintain that the Golden Gate Bridge, which would arise spontaneously if one gave the iron ore of which is constructed a million years or so to organize itself. Are you getting it? It's impossible. Doug X, a molecular biologist, said the probability of a protein with 150 amino acids, which is not the biggest, becoming a protein molecule, what are the chances? It is 1 in 10 to the power of 164. That is 10 with 164 zeros. Now, just to give you, people who are not mathematicians, when you talk about chance, this is what I mean. You go and get you get 10 to the power of 164 marbles, white one, okay? And then you take one red marble and you put it inside and mix it all up. And you blindfold and the chance of, at the first pick, pick the red marble. That's your chance. Now, just to put things in perspective, how big is the power, 10 to the power of 164? Let me give you some perspective, all right? The perspective is simply this. Scientists agree that in the whole universe, there are only 10 to the power of 80 elementary particles. Whole universe. All the particles come together, there are only 10 to the power of 80. Scientists agree with watching the speed of expansion that the Big Bang took place in 10 to the power of 16 seconds ago. Can you get a dimension of this? 10 to the power of 16 seconds ago, scientists said probably the Big Bang took place. There's just not enough time for 150 amino acid to form one protein, and there are thousands and millions of different things. It is totally impossible. However, as the molecular biologists probed deeper into the cell, they discovered something more amazing. They discovered that this was possible because embedded in the cell is what we now know as DNA. And within that cell, the DNA molecule gives information to the amino acid to form these cells. And it is a complex information. And this informational complexity tell us that there's a designer. Watch this and you'll blow your mind.
With computer animation, we can enter the cell to view this remarkable system at work. After entering the heart of the cell, we see the tightly wound strands of DNA, storehouses for the instructions necessary to build every protein in an organism. In a process known as transcription, a molecular machine first unwinds a section of the DNA helix to expose the genetic instructions needed to assemble a specific protein molecule. Another machine then copies these instructions to form a molecule known as messenger RNA. When transcription is complete, the slender RNA strand carries the genetic information through the nuclear pore complex, the gatekeeper for traffic in and out of the cell nucleus. The messenger RNA strand is directed to a two-part molecular factory called a ribosome. After attaching itself securely, the process of translation begins. Inside the ribosome, a molecular assembly line builds a specifically sequenced chain of amino acids. These amino acids are transported from other parts of the cell and then linked into chains often hundreds of units long. Their sequential arrangement determines the type of protein manufactured. When the chain is finished, it is moved from the ribosome to a barrel-shaped machine that helps fold it into the precise shape critical to its function. After the chain is folded into a protein, it is then released and shepherded by another molecular machine to the exact location where it is needed.
This is absolutely mind-boggling to perceive at this scale of size such a finely tuned apparatus, a device that's, that bears the marks of intelligent design and manufacture.
This man who just spoke is Dean Cannon. He and another scientist wrote the basic text for all university on chemical evolution. But a number of years after that, he said, I was totally wrong when he studied what is taking place at the deepest level of the cell. And yet that book is continuously taught as fact when he himself said, I was wrong, it is not true. You know something, as you look at that, what took place? I was excited. Praise the Lord. We are not just fearfully made. We are wonderfully made. Can you imagine what is taking place in every one of your cells right now? The amazing information complexity. It was Bill Gates who said, human DNA is like a computer program, but far, far more advanced than anything we have ever created. That's from Bill Gates who said, I can create a computer like that. And in our every cell, there are tremendously complex information software that produce all the cells that you need in the rest of the body. Now, why is it that scientists refuse to acknowledge that? You see, since the 19th century, and in fact since the time of Darwin, and part of because of his writing, The Origin of Species, scientists came to accept the convention or the definition of science that exclude the possibility of design as a scientific explanation. This convention has a name, and doesn't matter if you don't remember, it's called methodological naturalism. It just means that if you have to be scientific, if you call yourself a scientist, then you must limit yourself to explanation that invokes only natural causes. You cannot invoke intelligence as a cause. If you do that in any university right now, you will be thrown out of the faculty. You will be considered not academic and not scientific because it has to be. Now, but that's not science. Science must take in every option. You see, yet a highly intelligent scientist like Francis Crick, a British molecular biologist who actually discovered DNA, who rejects God, who rejects theism, he said, biologists must constantly keep in mind that what they see was not designed, but rather evolved. Can you imagine you sit in Dr. Crick's class, he tells all of you scientists and say, as you look at it, keep telling yourself, it's not designed, it's not designed, it's not designed. Why? Because it sure looks like design. You got it? But if you're a scientist, tell yourself, it's not design, it's not design. Otherwise, you're not a scientist. And yet, curiously, we make inferences to intelligent design all the time. It's part of our ordinary reasoning to recognize the effect of design. When you see something highly improbable, and this highly improbable happening fulfills an actual function, in probability, plus specification tells you about design. Look at this clip.
Consider, for example, these hieroglyphic messages carved upon the ruins of Egyptian monuments. No one would attribute the shapes and arrangements of these symbols to natural causes like sandstorms or erosion. Instead, we recognize them as the work of ancient scribes, intelligent human agents. Similar reasoning leads us to conclude that the mysterious stone figures on the shores of Easter Island were not formed by the actions of wind and water over great periods of time. Nor do we presume that plants could grow into these familiar shapes without some manner of intelligent guidance.
Of course, we make these inferences all the time, and we know they're correct. But the question is, on what basis do we make these inferences? What are the features that enable us to recognize intelligence?
According to Dembski, human beings correctly detect the activity of intelligence whenever they observe a highly improbable object or event that also matches a recognizable pattern. Just such a pattern is found in the Black Hills of South Dakota.
If you travel through the West, you'll see lots of different shapes on mountainsides, most of which mean nothing at all. They're just rocks strewn in various patterns. But what you don't see are the faces of Lincoln, Jefferson, Teddy Roosevelt, and George Washington on mountainsides. The only place you see that is in South Dakota. And the reason it's there is because a sculptor, an eccentric sculptor, decided that he wanted to honor these presidents by spending the larger part of his life chiseling their faces in the side of that mountain. That pattern is improbable. A random hillside is also improbable, but a random hillside doesn't specify anything. We do know, though, that there were four guys who were presidents of the United States who had particular patterns with their faces, and those patterns on the mountainside in South Dakota match faces elsewhere.
If I look up and see the faces, I immediately recognize that they match the faces of the four presidents that are known from money or portraits at the National Gallery or paintings and books. And so I realized when I look at Mount Rushmore, we have not only a highly improbable configuration of rock, but one which matches an independently given pattern that reliably indicates intelligence.
So we have a small probability, specification, it's design.
Have you got it, Church? Have you understood the deception that is permeating this world? From the evolutionary theory that says that God is redundant, is the delusion, when in fact there is nothing from the fossil record that shows that there was such a process of evolution, because there's no intermediary fossils. And yet you look deeper in the cell to make the jump that everything began from non-life to life in that simple cell shows that it's
utterly nonsense. That's why Paul says, don't be confused by this nonsense. It is nonsense. Do you now understand why God is so angry? In Romans chapter 1, verse 18, 22 says, but God shows his anger from heaven against all sinful, wicked people who suppress the truth by their wickedness. They know the truth about God because he has made it obvious to them. For ever since the world was created, people have seen the earth at the sky. Through everything God made, they can clearly see the invisible qualities, his eternal power and his divine nature. So they have no excuse, the Bible says, for not knowing God. Yes, they knew God. They wouldn't worship him as God or even give him thanks. And they began to think up foolish ideas of what God was like. As a result, their minds become dark and confused. And claiming to be wise, they instead became utter fools. The last statement is not meant to be a mockery. It's not meant to be the derision. But God is saying that we chose to be fools. Whether you are a simple child observing the sky and says, certainly behind this garden there's a gardener, to the ultimate molecular biologist who studied the intricacy of what happened in a simple cell, you cannot help but to say that God to be designed. And why do we refuse to accept that? Because we rather worship ourselves as God. Because the minute we assume that there is a, or we believe that there's a designer, then we have to say, why are we designed? What are we designed for? Suddenly, you have to ask the question, what is the intention of this great designer has in for our life? And you've got to submit to that, that he's a God who created us. You see, the Bible tells us that he didn't just create us fearfully, he created us wonderfully. You burst into history because God spoke life into you, and God put in you all the DNA that made you exactly what you are. The hair that you have, the eyes that you have, the complexion that you have, everything has been just streamlined by the DNA to be what you are. Every one of you is a special, wonderful creation of God. He tells us that we are men and women of significance. We are not the result of some accident or some random chance, but we are the workmanship of a God who is infinitely wise and ultimately powerful. You are different from anyone else in the world. Your fingerprint is never the same. Your eyes are never the same as anyone else. That's why they use this for security measure, because you are uniquely and wonderfully designed. And the Lord tells you, you are special. You have dignity and you have significance. That's why the psalmist, even as far back as the Old Testament, said in Psalm 139, he said, you made all the delicate inner parts of my body, knit me together in my mother's womb. Thank you for making me so wonderfully complex. Your workmanship is marvelous. How well I know it. You watch me as I was being formed in utter seclusion, as I was woven together in the dark of the womb. You saw me before I was born. Every day of my life was recorded in your book. Every moment was laid out before a single day has passed. How precious your thoughts about me. Oh God, they cannot be numbered. I can't even count them. They outnumber the grains of the sand. And then when I wake up, you are there. God is telling you, he loves you so much, he designed you for a purpose, but yet we walk away from him. And as a result of that, our minds have been corrupted. Our hearts have been hardened. As a result of that, the devil deceives us with lies concerning the spiritual world, and worse still, even with signs. Every day we are bombarded by these scientists who know. That's why I have no respect now from hearing what I've studied. They know that they don't have the fossil record as evidence. They know the complexity of the thing, and they choose not to even consider design as a scientific option. There's a deliberate lie. I was sharing this with a Love Singapore pastor, and he said, you know, one of them said, I begin to believe in this conspiracy theory that something is happening around the world. Whether you believe it or not, there's a conspiracy that comes from the devil that wants to blind our eyes and wants to confuse us with all these things that cause us to rob us from our living relationship with God. But you know what? God loves you so much. Not only did He make you so special and wonderful, He remade you in Jesus Christ. When we sin against God, our minds are confused, our hearts are hardened. But the Lord says, I do not want you to go this way because you're going to destroy yourself. You're going to be eternally separated from Me. So this is what the Bible says. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believe in Him will not perish, but eternal life. The Bible tells us that He loved us so much in that while we were so foolish, so stupid, so sinful, so hardened in our heart, while we were yet sinners, Christ came to die on our behalf, because a just and holy God cannot accept sin. Sin has to be dealt with, and sin got to be punished. And He said, I come and take the punishment on Myself. This is what the Bible says. God made Jesus Christ, who knew no sin, to become a sin on our behalf, so that He will reach out to us and say, now you can have a living relationship with Me, so that you, your sin can be put on Christ when He died on the cross, so that God can put His righteousness in you, so that when God looks at you, you're righteous, not because of who you are, but because of the imputed righteousness that God has put in your account. And God therefore say that I have not given you a spirit of slavery, of fear. You can now be given a spirit of sonship, that you can cry out to God and call Him not Creator, not just the Almighty, we call Him that, but we can call Him Father. Father, thank You for creating us. Thank You for making us so wonderful. And the Lord says that today, this message is for you. You are not here by accident. And if you are sitting here right now, and God began to, I know that arguments cannot finally convince you, but I hope that these arguments remove a roadblock in your life. It removes something that blocks you from understanding, because every time people share Christ, you think, this is unscientific, but I can tell you, it is not. It is they who are unscientific. They are not true to their scientific processes, but indeed, God is a God of science and of everything else. And as God has removed from you this barrier, some of you begin to sense that, wow, this is amazing. I've never thought of this. And the Holy Spirit began to convince you. And the Holy Spirit reached out His hand and said to you, come, My son, you can become a child of God. What does it take to become a child of God? Jesus put it, the Bible puts it very simply. He said, as many as receive Him, receive Jesus Christ in your life, acknowledge that He died for your sin, He created you wonderfully, and you want to be restored to Him by accepting what He had done for you on the cross as the forgiveness of your sin. And as many as receive Him, to them give the authority to become the sons and the daughters of God, even to those who believe on His name. If today, wherever you are, you open up that simple step of faith, I can tell you, science is based on faith when they talk about origin of life. They make that jump that cannot be proven anywhere. But I want to tell you this, the Lord says, put your faith in Me. Life is full of faith. Every time you make a decision is on faith. But yet this faith is based on something that I've shown you as evidence that there is a designer. We couldn't have come by chance. Today, will you open up your heart to Him and receive Jesus Christ into your life? You may say, Pastor Khong, how do I do it? Well, I cannot do it on your behalf, but I could help you. Right here is a divine appointment. In a moment, I'm going to lead you in a prayer. This prayer is designed for people who have never accepted Jesus Christ into your life. But today, God has spoken to you. You've never done it before, but today, God opens up the heart. And you say, Lord, I take that step of faith. I've been fool all these years. I've been ignorant. I don't mean to be so stupid or so foolish. But today, God has opened my eyes. I will take this step of faith and accept Jesus Christ into my life. Some of you say, maybe I don't have enough faith. Don't worry about the faith you don't have. Exercise the faith that God has put in your heart. Some of you say, I don't know enough about the Bible to be a Christian. You don't need to know everything about the Bible before you become a Christian any more than you need to know everything about a car before you drive it. In fact, it is only when you take that step and turn on the ignition and drive it that you begin to know how the car operates. God is just saying, don't make things more complicated than what it is. God simply reaches out His hand and says, I die for you. If today you were to pray this prayer with Me, I'm going to lead you in that prayer. I will say one line and you follow
follow after me allow. It's prayer designed for people who have never accepted Christ. But today, whether you are in Suntec's auditorium or you're right here, if you were to follow my prayer, I will say one line, I pause, and you repeat after me aloud. But mean it in your heart and really say, today is the day I decide. Then today, wherever you're sitting, God invades your life with His presence. He forgives your sin. He makes you a child of God. Don't say no. Don't say tomorrow. There was one time, a girl in my church, I never forgot. He says, Pastor, pray. My sister, after many years, do not want to come to church. She's really stubborn. But next week, she's coming to church with me. And she's going to hear the gospel. I pray for her. But the sad thing is, she never made it next week. Because she was in a coma before that. She had a stroke. And she went into eternity, and we're not sure whether she prayed. We prayed with her over the bed, but we don't know if she actually received. You know, the Bible says, don't say, tomorrow I go there. Tomorrow I'll do this. Sometimes God says, your life might be required of you tonight. It's not a scare tactic. These are reality of life. If today God give you an opportunity, that's why the Bible says, now is the day of salvation. Now is the acceptable time. Do not, when you hear the voice of God speaking to you, do not harden your heart one more time. So I'm going to lead you in that prayer. If you have never prayed to receive Christ, will you pray aloud with me? I want all of you who have never prayed this prayer, today take that step of faith. But when I lead the new people to pray that prayer, I want every Christian to join in so that they accompany you into the presence of God. Will you do that right now? Let's all bow our head and close our eyes. No one moving around. Only those who are on duty. No one looking around except those who are on duty. Close your eyes, bow your head. I want to pray for you first, and then I want to ask you to follow me in that prayer if you have never accepted Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit of truth, just release that truth, burst it into our heart. And then speak to each one whose heart are open. And I declare that this will be a day of salvation for them. Lord, as we glorify you, draw many to yourself. With every head bowed, every eye closed, I'm going to lead you in that prayer. If you, somebody you, don't worry about people around you, but you, your hearts are open. Don't worry about whether your husband is a Christian, your wife is a Christian, your girlfriend is a Christian. You know, they need to know the Lord too. But first, make up their mind. Take that step of faith. Will you pray with me right now? I say one line, you follow me, and all the Christians join in. Let's do it together with your head bowed, with your eyes closed. Dear Heavenly Father, say it again. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for your wonderful love.
Thank you for your wonderful love.
That I am fearfully,
and wonderfully made. And wonderfully made.
Today I open my heart to you.
Today I open my heart to you.
I repent of my pride.
I repent of my foolishness.
Please come into my life, Lord Jesus. I believe you died for my sin. And you rose again from the dead. Come into my life and make me a child of God.
Forgive my sins.
Cleanse me from the inside. And of today, I give you my life. You are the master of my life. Help me to follow you. All the days of my life. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I want every head bow, every eye closed. I just know that there's somebody you, whether you are in Suntec or somebody you sitting here in a corner or in the middle, God spoke to. And in a very earnest and honest way, you pray that prayer. If you do, the Spirit of truth has come into you. God says, I made you a child of God. I want to pray a prayer for you. I want to know who you are. This is what I'm going to do. In a minute, I'm going to count to three. I count one, two, and three. And the minute I count to three, I want everyone who prayed that prayer for the first time in your life and really mean it. Or some, you have gone to church before, but and you made some prayer before, but today you really realize. And today, God convicted you and you say, I give my life completely to the Lord. I, for the first time, open my heart to Jesus. If that's what you did just now, at a count of three, I want you to raise your hand. You don't need to lift up your head, open your eyes, keep your head bowed, your eyes closed, but raise up your hand and don't put it down. By doing that, you're saying, Pastor Khong, just now when you lead me in the prayer, I prayed, whether openly or in my heart, with you and mean it in my heart. Could you pray a blessing for me?
I would be delighted to do so. Whether you are right here in this auditorium or in Suntec City, when I count to three, you just raise your hand and keep it up. I want to pray for you. I count right now. One, two, three. Raise your hand. Just raise your hand high. Raise it up high so I can see you. I see your hand. Is there someone else upstairs in the auditorium right there in Suntec City? Keep your hands up. Keep your hands up and say, I give my life to Jesus. This is the day of salvation. I open my heart to Him. I want to just pray for you. Is there someone else? I'm going to pray for you right now. Father in heaven, thank you for those who have given their hearts to Jesus. Thank you that your truth has dispelled the lies. Thank you that this is the day of salvation for them. In the name of Jesus, I declare that their sins are forgiven, and this day they are the special child of God, and this is the day of salvation. I declare in Jesus' name that they will walk with you all the rest of their life. We thank you, Lord, and bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's all stand together, shall we? Come on, let's give God a big round of applause. Thank the Lord. Doesn't sound like you're excited about the fact that you're wonderfully made. Come on, let's thank the Lord for that. You don't need to be intimidated by scholars or high-sounding people. You don't need to be, because God has created us. Amen? This is what we're going to do. I know a number of you have prayed with me to accept Christ. Some of you have lifted up your hand. Some of you may not have, because you're kind of, you feel kind of strange to do that. But I tell you this. If you have really prayed that prayer, or if you want to, this is what I want to do. I want the whole church to pray for you. I'm going to come to three. If you raise your hand just now, or you prayed that prayer in a cell group with somebody, and today you have never come forward on a weekend, when I come to three, I want you to take your belongings. The friend that brought you will come down with you. I want you to stand in front here, and we're going to pray a blessing for you. And I want to ask that the whole church will release a blessing so that you will walk and know this God whom you have given your life to, whether you're in Suntec City or right here. So I count to three. We want to welcome you. One, two, three. Come on. Come on out. This is the day of salvation. And those in Suntec City, you come forward. This is the day. I know you have prayed to receive Christ. I know you have given your heart to the Lord. I know the Lord has removed that barrier, that blockage. I just praise God for what He's doing. And those in Suntec, you come forward. This is the day of salvation. We're not here to embarrass you. We're to pray a blessing from you. Those who are coming from upstairs, come. We're waiting here. Come forward here. And we want to pray for you and say, God is the God of your life right now. And those in the Suntec City, even if you have not prayed aloud, but God has spoken to you, I want you to come forward, because this is amazing. It's a scientific thing to believe that there's a designer behind every one of our lives. Can we just come take one step forward, everybody? Take one step forward, because there are some more people coming behind. We don't want to block them. Praise God for that. Praise God for that. Listen to me. We must acknowledge that we're not mocking people who don't believe, but I just want to expose that sometimes we're so programmed to think that it's not scientific to believe in God. I tell you, it's more scientific to believe in God, because it's a fact and you can be shown more and more with evidence. But more than that, what you did today is to develop a personal relationship with God. You know what? I know my wife exists, because I walked with her almost for 40 years. I talked to her, and we hold hands together, and we journey together. The most powerful evidence of God's reality is that you can walk with Him. You can actually talk to Him. And you know what? He talks back. He talks back through His Word. He talks back through the Bible. He talks back in your heart. You're going to experience Him. But at this moment, the Bible says you are born again into God's family. You are a little baby, even if you're old or young. And a baby have eyes that don't see very much, have ears that don't hear very well, fingers that do not, you know, are not fully functional. But because there's life, it's a matter of time. I spent a whole night, two nights ago, nursing my granddaughter. I mean, she's a milk drinking machine. Okay, that's the only thing in life that she can do right now. But I know is she keep drinking and keep just growing. Those the brains, the hands, the leg will develop. It's the same thing. And that's why we call you forward, because a baby needs a family to take care of. And so we're going to pray for you, the whole church. And after that, a pastor will bring you to a room outside. Take down your particulars because we're serious about walking with you. Give us a chance to care for you so that you know this God, not just in your brain, but in your mind and in your heart and the totality of you. Church, can you stretch your hand and pray for them and those in Suntec City as well? Say with me, in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
We welcome you in the family of God.
We declare that you are a child of God.
May the blessing of God come upon you.
May the blessings of God come.
Your family.
Your family.
Your health.
Your health.
Your emotions.
Your emotions.
Your work.
Your work.
Your study.
Your study.
And all your relationships.
All your relationships.
May you discover.
May you discover
the joy of knowing God.
The joy of knowing God.
And of walking with Him.
And walking with Him.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Come on, let's welcome them. Turn around. The Lord says it is in Him that we live and move and have our being. I bless you that you will not only know God in your mind, but you'll know God in your heart and know God in your spirit. And all the days of your life, you will grow in the knowledge of God in every aspect. You will grow into maturity so that you can become a blessing to others. So may God's grace be upon you. May His love envelop you. May the constant relationship you have with Him through the Holy Spirit affirm His reality, His presence, and His power in your life. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Come back next week. I'm going to talk about the moral necessity of God. Come back.